Egyptian licorice with so much honey. Hello, dudes, dudettes, duders, and everyone in between, and welcome to How to Do Everything So You Don't Have To, the show where we teach you how to think like a producer. Media tends to either be easy to make or easy to watch. At least that used to be the maxim. If you produce multi-camera video podcasts or conversational corporate content, that may not be the case anymore. We recently released an hour-long interview that took a one-man crew 5 minutes to produce. Five is the best number. And that's not an exaggeration. The video in question is a conversation that I had with my wife, Swinky, the first long-form discussion we've had since 2021. While the actual content of the conversation might not be essential viewing for people who don't know us, I believe that the technical process of shooting and editing it warrants a deeper dive, because that production was made possible by tools and software that simply didn't exist 5 years ago. Some of it didn't exist 5 weeks ago. I was the entire crew for the recording and editing of that interview, and I'm being honest when I say that I spent about 5 minutes of work on the entire project. While that 5 minutes doesn't include camera setup, data management, and rendering time, it does include mic check, camera roll and cut, and actual editing time. In this video, we're going to cover how we achieved this level of efficiency, including the gear we used, with a price breakdown. We'll talk about the hands-off approach we took to editing, and finally, I'll share my thoughts on the way this technology will affect the jobs market and video production at a larger scale. And don't worry, it's not all doom and gloom, and I believe that I can justify my optimism. Of course, there is a comment section down below if you'd like to tell me how I'm wrong. Let's start out with the gear we used. This production was a 3-camera, 2-mic video, which is just the right size for most podcasts, fireside chats, and corporate-style interviews. Some of the gear is incredibly specific. Some of it is what we had sitting around. Let's break it down and run a B&H shopping cart so you can see how the prices add up. For microphones, we went with a pair of SM7Bs. Maybe not the most creative mic solution out there, but they get the job done, and it's the mic that people are most familiar with. So if you want something that your average podcast guest already has experience with, you'd be hard-pressed to find a better fit at any price point. Those come in at $399 apiece, plus another $130 per mic for the arms that we use. Of course, a mic isn't terribly useful if it isn't plugged into something, so you'll need cables, and we're using regular old Neutrik 25 footers. For tying the mics into the cameras, we used Condor Blue XLR to XLR mini converters, which brings us to the cameras. For this project, we used Blackmagic Pocket Cinema 4K cameras because they're the cheapest option with XLR in and the ability to jam timecode and trigger record from an ATEM. For this setup, we shot RAW on each camera, so we used 1TB Samsung SSDs. Two people sitting relatively still and chatting isn't going to stress any compression algorithm, so we set the camera to constant bitrate with an 8:1 compression. For lenses, we used a pair of Olympus 12-40mm for the close-ups and a Laowa 7.5mm for the wide. The cameras are mounted on small rig tripods, each one costing 160 bones. These are awful tripods and not something I'd recommend for anything other than locked-off shots in low-budget studio environments. All three cameras feed into an ATEM Mini via HDMI, and this is where the first bit of magic happens. Even the cheapest ATEM on the market can be used not only to jam timecode on Pocket Series cameras, but also trigger record and cut, two features that will be essential when we get to post-production. There are some limitations here, and I'll cover them as efficiently as possible. First, if you want to keep an eye on record health while you're conducting the interview, you have to turn overlays on, which means that even if you're using an ATEM ISO, the only recordings usable for broadcast will be the in-camera RAWs, which is a little risky. If you have an ATEM ISO, you can leave overlays off at the camera level and bake a little bit of redundancy into your workflow, but the cost is that you won't know if one of the cameras stops recording mid-conversation. Also, ATEM files will be 1080 and have inter-frame compression, which is better than nothing, but not as good as 4K RAW. For the monitor, we used the AOC 16T10, which is a monitor we use a lot on mobile productions because at about 100 bones, they're affordable, and we can fit three in a Pelican 1510. So we just buy them in stacks and have them sitting around anytime a production needs some screens. B&H doesn't carry these, so we'll just chuck a couple of similar monitors into the cart, a Mac Mini, and a keyboard and mouse. soup to nuts, the entire kit comes in at under 10K, which isn't bad considering it all adds up to a 3-camera studio with industry standard mics and one button 4K raw recording. That's not a bad jumping off point for acquisition, and at that price, it's kind of incredible. But recording is only half the story. Let's talk about post-production. Editing is where things got really interesting in this experiment. When it comes to recording, the window of what will get the job done is pretty narrow, and solutions are created by throwing money at the problem until it goes away. You want one button 4K raw recording across multiple cameras for under 10 grand? This is the kit that does it. You could save a couple of bucks on SSDs or lenses if you wanted, but that's pretty much it. The nice thing is that we're already done spending at this point. All of editing is going to be done in DaVinci Resolve, and if you bought the Pocket 4K cameras new, you got one full studio license with each camera, leaving you with two unused licenses. It's an embarrassment of riches. Let's get into that post environment. At the time of producing this, version 20 of Resolve is still in its beta, so your mileage may vary and the workflow may change as the software gets an official release. But because the workflow is so simple, we decided to demo the entire editing process, start to finish, without cuts, so you can see that I'm not exaggerating when I say that we produced the entire video in fewer than 5 minutes. Here is that process, step by step, so that you can replicate the workflow yourself. First, create a new project and import the 3-camera raw recordings into the media pool. Select all 3 clips and create a multicam clip using the timecode to sync the files. Drag that multicam clip into your timeline and load up your preview window. Switch your preview window to multicam, and now you can click the multicam AI edit tool. We'll go over the settings in a minute, but not right now because the clock is still ticking. Click analyze and congratulations, your editing work is done. Go out and grab a coffee, tea, or other libation and enjoy the afternoon while the computer does the work for you. The AI edit is done entirely on your machine, and you can confirm this by loading up your system monitor. You'll notice that it taxes your GPU and CPU, but there's no data up or down on the network. Because the edit is being done locally, the speed at which it executes will be affected by the machine you're using. We're on the cheapest M4 Mac Mini available and find that edits take a bit more than half the runtime of the program on fast mode and about the runtime on better mode, maybe a little bit less. Again, your mileage may vary. When you get back, you'll have something that I would describe as surprisingly competent. There were some decisions that I didn't agree with on the edit, but we'll get into those in a minute. Also, the full AI edit is available on our YouTube channel if you'd like to see it and find things to not like about it on your own. Before we get into that, let's get into what you can actually change in the settings. The first setting that you can adjust is the minimum edit duration. This is how short a clip can be at its shortest. Audiences have been trained in ways that they aren't even aware of. A good example of this is live multicam television. Because the shows are being cut live, there tends to be a minimum cut length of about 3 seconds. The reason for this is that it takes about 3 seconds for the director to ready a camera and cut to it. So, if you want your AI edit to feel more like a live edit done by a human team, you would kick this number up from 1 second to 3. The next option on the list is edit delay. This is how long it takes from when the speaker changes to when the camera cuts to their face. Resolve again defaults a little bit on the faster side at 0.3 seconds of delay. If you want to do something more like a human-driven broadcast, you can slow this down to 1 second, which is about how long it takes to call a cut and have the editor actually press the button. The next option is a tick box that allows you to select the wide-angle shot yourself or let Resolve guess. I like to select the wide myself, but that's because I like to pretend I'm contributing to the edit. The other options have a bit more impact on the edit, though. Once the wide angle is defined, you can set the frequency to low, medium, or high. We tend to prefer to set this to low because once geography is established, it's all about that eye contact, baby. Wide for the intro and outro is great, especially if you're going to YouTube and you plan to have a bunch of thumbnails pop up during the outro. Go ahead and turn Use Wide Angle for Silence off. Honestly, the biggest problem with the edit we released on our channel was that it popped to the wide every time we weren't talking. There are times when my wife and I prefer to think before we say something, so we found the edit dumping to the wide way more than felt natural. The next option you can noodle with is whether you want the result delivered faster or better. Since you're not really doing anything as it processes, it seems to me that there's no reason to go with the faster option. The final option you can tick is the Use Audio Only Fast Analysis box, which focuses on the audio only for the edit, cutting to the camera that is making the most noise. This is functional, but seems a bit superfluous. It's not like I'm doing the work on an AI edit, so I don't really care if it takes a few minutes to do a barely competent edit or 30 minutes to do a fairly competent edit. One option delivers a better cut and gives me more time to sip gazpacho. So, how do we tie all this together? As someone who finds terrific value from long-form, protein-rich conversations, the potential of this workflow is immediately obvious and incredibly powerful. The challenge with that format of interview boils down to time and technology. The world is overflowing with wildly intelligent people who have ocean-deep knowledge and an eagerness to share what they know with others. The two shortages that I see are in technological knowledge regarding how to capture high-quality audio and video, and the time available to package and deliver the contents once they're captured. I think I've made a reasonable case in this video that the technological challenges can be met under $10,000 and that the amount of work that goes into producing this style of content has been reduced so aggressively as to be negligible. There's simply no excuse for low-quality, multi-camera interview-style content anymore. It's more affordable than ever, and the time commitment needed to record and edit is so small that if you can't find the time to do it right, that is 5 minutes, maybe you shouldn't be doing it. But what about that AI threat? With all that in mind, I'd like to address the potential threat this poses to jobs, particularly entry-level post-production jobs. Look, man, I know that AI alarmism is popular on YouTube, but, and I'm just speaking as an editor who's been doing this for 20 years, this job sucked. I hate the first pass on a long-form multi-camera edit. It's completely boring and, more importantly, teaches nothing to interns or assistant editors. You don't learn the rhythms of editing from long-form multi-cam projects because the rhythms are set by the conversation, not the editor. Sure, you can tighten things up a bit here and there, but you learn actual rhythm and pacing from documentary or narrative filmmaking. All you learn from multicam editing is how to cut to the speaker when they're speaking and the listener when they're reacting. It ain't rocket surgery. Furthermore, as a producer, I don't learn anything about the editor if this is the work they're doing. I can't get acquainted with their strengths and weaknesses because all I know is that they can cut to the speaker when they're speaking or a listener when they're reacting. This type of work reveals nothing about the employee, so as an employer, it really isn't that useful for me. It's such dull work that I actually don't ask anyone I hire to do it. I do it myself and frequently nod off mid-edit. I believe that it's easier to retain a team by giving them projects that excite them than it is by giving them repetitive tasks that have no room for growth or self-expression. So, in the interest of retaining the talent we have access to, I do those first pass edits myself. Within our ecosystem, no jobs are lost. All these tools do is free us up to spend more time on interesting tasks. Instead of mindlessly clicking on camera buttons, the editor could be going through the transcripts of the conversation, identifying key moments for social polls, and finding the bits of the conversation that would actually inspire and delight audience members. Then, as soon as the AI edit is done, a real human can jump in and do actual creative editing. There are AI tools that will chip away at the work people find meaningful and inspiring. This tool set is not among that group. This is a tool that takes one of the most time-consuming and least rewarding tasks of long-form interview editing and reduces it to dust, making it easier than ever for brilliant minds and warm hearts to get their ideas out in an elegant package. Pardon the optimism, but I'm still kind of soaring high from having had a conversation with my wife. She's an incredible woman, and if you haven't seen the chat, I'd highly recommend it. Until then,